Good evening, Holy Cross people. Welcome. Thanks for joining us. I'm Tom Landy, the director of the McFarland Center for Religion, Ethics, and Culture at the college. The McFarland Center sponsors lectures, discussions, conferences that explore basic human questions of meaning, morality, and mutual obligation. In the coming year, in light of a whole set of troubling socio-political challenges in America and around the world, the McFarland Center is going to be working with faculty and other members of our community to think about the state of thinking in a post-truth age. We'll be saying more about that in the coming months. But tonight, we have an opportunity to explore one life and death implication of the situation we find ourselves in. We can talk about how our public health crisis, with 28 million illnesses and 500,000 deaths, has been exacerbated by an epistemic crisis in our country. Public health officials and reporters have been challenged not only by fast-changing data and recommendations on the virus, but also about disinformation and about Americans' skepticism to accept that true scientific information. I'm really happy tonight to welcome Caroline Chen, an investigative reporter for ProPublica, who will talk about the challenges she faces in covering the coronavirus pandemic. I also want to mention I'm grateful to Professors Jeff Finley and Dennis Kennedy, who are co-teaching a class on pandemic policy, for their help in bringing her here tonight. COVID-19 is not Caroline's first experience with an outbreak. She lived through the SARS epidemic as a teenager growing up in Hong Kong, and then covered Ebola in 2014 and the Zika virus in 2016 for Bloomberg News. Last March, as COVID-19 reached pandemic status, she began writing columns to help fellow reporters and readers to interpret the fast-paced and changing information on the virus. She also teaches students at Columbia Journalism School how to evaluate and analyze data for appropriateness, context, and meaning. Previously, Caroline won awards on a heart transplant program in New Jersey that prioritized metrics over patient care in 2019, and a story with Riley Wong in 2018 on racial disparities in cancer clinical trials. She has a master's degree from the Stabile Program in Investigative Journalism at Columbia Journalism School, where she was awarded a Pulitzer Traveling Fellowship. She earned a bachelor's degree from Stanford University with a major in English and a minor in math. There's a good combination. She'll speak for 30 minutes and then we'll open up for questions. You can raise your hand to ask questions or type them into the private chat to me, and I'll pose them for you. If they're in the private chat, I'll presume they're supposed to be private, but I certainly welcome you to ask them directly. The event is being recorded and will be posted online within a day or two. Welcome, Caroline.
Thank you so much, Tom. And thank you so much for having me here today. I'm really excited to get to speak to you all. And so I'm gonna try to share my screen here. And so just give me a second. So again, thank you so much for having me. I'm a health reporter at ProPublica, and I know that you guys are not journalists, most of you here, though if any of you guys end up having an interest in journalism, feel free to reach out to me. I'm happy to chat about that more. But I wanted to bring you my perspective on public health reporting, particularly with the lens on disinformation and sort of sorting through information here. A little bit about me. Thank you, Tom. You've given me such a nice introduction here. So as Tom mentioned, I'm from Hong Kong. I grew up there. My parents still live there. And so I did have an opportunity to see a previous epidemic with SARS-1 or SARS Classic, as it's now sometimes called, and grew up there, came to the US, and this is some of my reporting history. And I'm now an investigative health reporter at ProPublica. Some of the stories I've covered before include sort of a wide range of healthcare work. You'll see on the right side here, if you've followed a Theranos' story, that's one of the more interesting interviews I've gotten to do with Theranos' CEO. I've written about clinical trials and racial disparities there, about different aspects of the healthcare, either the business side all the way to, you know, what's happening at the border. Kind of a range, and I feel lucky to have gotten the opportunity to sort of see all angles of the healthcare system. So Before we get into, you know, specifically specific examples, actually, I just wanted to pause and say, you know, I'm going to give some examples today, which include other people's work. And when I talk about best practices here, if I give examples of other journalists or other news organizations' works that I would put as examples that I would not want to do, I absolutely do not mean to be disparaging, you know, other of my peers' work. I'm just using them as examples to try to illustrate a point here. And I really see this as a, you know, I could definitely make that same mistake if I was in their shoes. I think I'm in a very lucky position right now, because if you're not familiar with ProPublica, we are a nonprofit news organization that focuses primarily on investigative reporting and deep dives. And so I'm really, really lucky in that I get to take a lot of time with my stories. And previously I worked at Bloomberg News, which is a newswire, and newswires are often, you know, those reporters have to work really, really quickly. And so the pressures that some reporters are under to put out a story really quickly and have to make decisions really quickly mean that they don't have the luxury that I do to really think about like how to best present a story. So I just want to acknowledge that up front, that I think I am often in a much more fortunate position than a lot of my peers. And, you know, any examples that I put up today as sort of not best practices is, you know, not in any way to mean that I'm disparaging another reporter's work. So with that said, the first question I wanted to just ask is, you know, what is a reporter's job during a pandemic? So I think in a moment like this, we really are going back to basics here. We're trying to keep the public informed. We often use this term called service journalism, which is really, we are serving the public. So we're giving our readers information about the latest in whether it is public policy, healthcare policy, the latest in science, so that readers can make educated decisions about what they're going to do, what they should not do, where they should go, for example, to get a vaccine. So this is information. Having that as duty number one, that then influences and poses questions for newsrooms, such as, when do you go into the field? So this is often called field reporting or man on the street reporting. You know, in a non-pandemic situation, we do this all the time. You know, like I'm often, my instinct is always like, go out, get out, talk to people on the street. When the CDC is saying, stay at home, avoid crowds, don't talk to people, can I go out and do man on the street reporting? Can I do that potentially when I'm going to endanger a source by giving them COVID? Can I do that if it is in service of getting the public information? You know, so we've had to tussle with this in our newsroom, where normally my instinct is whenever I'm reporting a story, it is always better to go meet someone in person when I can. It is always better to go out and get the scene in person when I can. I always prioritize in-person contact over the phone when I can. And we've had to completely upend that model, where now we have to basically, we can only go if the story is so important that we have to justify the risk of going. Like, we've really upended some models in our newsroom. Another question that's come up, which is totally above my pay grade, is what stays behind the paywall? So obviously, you know, newsrooms need to make money. ProPublica does not operate on a paywall model. We operate on a donation model, but a lot of newsrooms do operate on a paywall model. So if your duty is to keep the public informed, you know, what stays behind the paywall, what doesn't? So you've seen a lot of newsrooms put some coronavirus stories in front of the paywall throughout the pandemic and some behind. And as I said, this is above my pay grade here. This is the sort of decision that oftentimes the publishers grapple with, but I think it is a really interesting one to think about, you know, how you balance sort of the business side, you have to keep your paper afloat, with, you know, how your service aspect as a reporter. you know, as a reporter, you always have, the goal is to get the information to your readers as quickly as possible. So how do you break news without breaking trust, basically without screwing up and making a mistake? So information in a pandemic is constantly changing. To give you an example, early on, I was trying to write this story about, I had this notion that I had learned from my sources that the CDC tests were flawed and we had not a lot of capacity in the US to perform testing. And so I was trying to nail down the exact amount of capacity we had in the test. I wanted to be able to say we can do X amount of tests a week. This was in mid-February. And I did a ton of reporting to nail down this number that I really wanted to bring to the public to be able to say, this is how much testing we can do right now, because it was shockingly low. And I thought being able to put that out there would show people how little capacity the US had. I think that notion was correct, but it turned out that information was changing really, really quickly. So I finally did, you know, a monumental amount of reporting, talking to state lab sources, federal lab sources, CDC sources, other epidemiologists. I nailed down a number. We started writing a story explaining why this was the case. You know, the fact that the CDC's had a flawed test, everything that was going on. And then I called back one of my sources, and he said, you know, the number, the thing I told you like 4 hours ago, that's changed now. That's wrong. And I thought, we can't write the story this way with this number in the headline, because part of it is knowing the nature of your platform. So ProPublica, as I said, is an investigative journalism shop. Our stories have a longer shelf life. We're not like a newswire like Dow Jones or the Associated Press or Bloomberg, where they're constantly putting out stories that can be updated over and over again. So I went to my editor and I said, I can put out a story that is correct at the very moment we publish. Like, it's accurate, but then like 3 hours later, it might not be accurate. And I just don't think we can structure the story that way. Because these labs and how much capacity they have is literally changing hour by hour. And I'm just not comfortable putting this number out anymore. She's like, well, is it accurate? I was like, it is accurate right now, but it might not be accurate by tomorrow morning. So we talked about it and we said, look, the point that we're really trying to get across here is that the US is not prepared for this virus that is coming. And we have a flawed CDC test that has put us in this position. So we completely reorganized the story. She was like, rewrite, like reshape the story. And we rewrote it as like the CDC's missteps have basically put us weeks behind where we should be. And that was a call we had to make, knowing what our platform looks like and understanding that if we then sort of had to change this number over and over again, like we would sort of lose our readers' trust. So the other question I think about a lot is, how do I convey the process of science to a reader? Because science is constantly updating during a pandemic. So, you know, one of the examples I have here on the right is from a story I did on ventilators, sort of this was maybe April, May, when a lot of people were really worried about going to the hospital and worried that, you know, if they got on a ventilator that they would die. And there was just not a lot of information out at that time. So one thing that I think about a lot is, you know, how do I kind of show the readers my work? So I kind of try to put together multiple studies. I've done a lot of linking in my work, like more than I normally do. So I show them a way to go to the original source if they want to. So there's a lot of links. And then I also put a lot of dates. So I say, you know, as of March, this is what the science shows, as of May. So even if somebody comes along a little bit later, comes back to the story, they'll get a sense of time. And if I can even show them, like, there is this study that's underway that will be able to answer this other question, and we get this answer later on, that kind of shows them that science is not static. Because I think a lot of readers have been sort of pushed around by, like, oh, like you said this thing earlier, like that masks are not going to help us. And now you're saying wear masks. Why is that? I think it's really the reporter's responsibility to explain that we may not know everything right at the beginning, especially when there's a new virus. And so I see that as my job as a science reporter to explain, like, this is what we know now. This is what we don't know now. This is what we're going to know in a few months. So that sort of leads me to this point, which is that like context really matters. You can be accurate at a sentence level, but wrong on a story level. So the example here on the right, I think I'm kind of covering my own thing here. You know, the CDC to investigate death of Nebraska man who received COVID vaccine dose. You're seeing a lot of headlines like that. I always have to just presume that my reader is going to only read the headline, you know, on Twitter or something like that, and then not read my story. So, you know, a reporter could say, that's an accurate headline. But to me, the takeaway of a reader is probably going to be that the COVID vaccine killed this man. And I don't want that, you know, you have to think about like what the reader's takeaway is going to be and think about that. And I think especially right now, reporters have to be aware of the power of headlines, especially with the ability of them to be shared on social media. So I think, you know, again, similarly with side effects like anaphylaxis, putting the context of the denominator, how many of these cases are happening, is it significant? Because I have to think about like, what does the reader care about? The reader cares about, is this something that's going to affect me? And make their choices. And like we as reporters have to make our choices accordingly as to whether we cover this at all, how we cover it, what the headline looks like, and what is the information that we put in what order. So it doesn't really help a reader if you put, you know, the information that, well, maybe the vaccine didn't cause this man's death in like the 17th paragraph. Again, you're accurate, you put it there, but the order in which you put it also matters. So these are all kind of things that I think about when I'm writing a story. This is going to be a little bit nerdy maybe, but this has been one of like my kind of ongoing rants throughout this pandemic is like units. Units matter a lot. So I always think about like trying to get the units in my story in people, if possible. So what do I mean by that? So I don't know if you guys remember back in March, March or April, when we were mostly using CDC tests, people kept talking about test kits. And this was because the CDC was sending out boxes of test kits. And each one of those test kits had about 700 tests in them, but the CDC's recommendation was that you do two swabs per person so that you could validate, which meant that each test kit could test 350 people. And there was a ton of confusion from state to state with different officials reporting in different ways. So, you know, one state, let's say if every state got one test kit, some officials would say, well, we have two tests, you know, one test kit. And then the next state over, they would say, we have 700 tests. And the next state over would say, we have 350 tests, meaning that they could test 350 people. And this was causing mass confusion, and it was totally driving me nuts, because at the end of the day, I think when you say something like, we have 200 test kits or whatever it is at a, you know, at a US-wide level, people just hear that, your readers read that, and they're not going to do the math in their head because they don't know this sort of detail. They just hear it as people. And so if your readers are going to hear it as people, you should give it to them in people. So I have been on the soapbox since the start of the pandemic being like, give it in people always, you know, and I think that officials sometimes take advantage of this. So like Biden right now has been, you know, doing this like 100 million shots in 100 days. And people are interpreting that as like, we're going to give vaccines to 100 million people in 100 days. And I'm like, no. You got to divide that by two, because the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines are two-shot vaccines. So they're getting credit for more people than they are actually doing in their campaign. And they're, you know, Biden's campaign is not doing this in units of people either. So this thing that's really kind of driving me nuts, because people always just interpret whatever they're given in people, but that's often not what the officials are actually saying. So really, I think, again, this is coming from, think about it in your reader's perspective. How are they going to interpret it? And then try to give them the information in the unit that's going to be most understandable to them. And frankly, it then makes everything the most apples to apples when you're doing comparisons. which goes to, you know, you're not here to do PR. So there's this George Orwell quote that says, journalism is printing what someone else does not want printed. Everything else is public relations. It's a little bit over the top. I don't think that's always true, but, you know, especially in investigative journalism, I do think that it's something to keep in mind. I think when we think about this notion of doing PR, we often think like, you know, I'm not doing PR for a company, you know, like I'm not just reprinting Pfizer's press releases or whatever. But I think you don't think sometimes about the notion of like, I shouldn't just, you know, take for granted what a whole country is putting out. What I mean by that is, you know, even early on in the pandemic, you know, for example, country by country, the way they were doing case counts was not necessarily apples to apples. So China at one point was counting only pneumonia cases, people who had pneumonia and a positive PCR test as a COVID case. For the longest time they were not, and then they switched to positive PCR with a positive image, like lung scan, as a positive COVID case. None of these count asymptomatic people who have a positive PCR as a case. And we now know, of course, that there are a lot of people who are asymptomatic. And then at one point they switched, you know, I think partly because there was a lot of pressure from the WHO to count asymptomatics, and then their case count soared. And then they kind of reversed and backtracked, and then their cases went back down. I don't think any reporter could have necessarily gotten the true number of cases in China. But I think at least knowing the case definition is really important. And not just saying, taking for granted that this is the case, because I think what that leads a lot of reporters to do potentially is to do apples to apples comparisons, which are not fair to say, like, look at China compared to this other country. And you can't really do that because their definitions of case counts are not the same. So this is one of those things that I think, you know, you can't just take at face value when someone says, oh, we have this number of cases. You have to look a little bit deeper and say, well, how are you counting cases? Sort of similarly, on the right here is a story that my colleagues did pretty early on. I don't know how much you guys follow New York politics here, but there was a while where Governor Cuomo was very, very popular in how he was handling the pandemic. And my colleagues did a pretty deep scrutiny in how he was handling the nursing homes. And, you know, now Governor Cuomo's fortunes have turned and he's not as popular right now, but I think at that point in time when they wrote this story, he was very popular and they just were not taking at face value, you know, how the public sentiment was and really scrutinizing how he was handling the nursing homes and looking at the actual numbers to write this story. So I'm just keeping an eye on time here, but you know, one of the very specific difficulties that has turned up in this pandemic, which is pretty new compared to anything I've seen before, is how preprints are covered. So let me back up here and explain for anybody who's not familiar what a preprint is. So normally when a new study comes out by a scientist, they write up their manuscript and then they submit it to a journal for publication. And that manuscript, sort of like a essay draft, gets then sent to usually a few scientists, you know, usually two or three, for what's called peer review. So these are scientists that are not involved in the study at all. They get comments, and then the journal will either publish it after it's gone through revision. Sometimes it gets rejected altogether. This process can take months. Sometimes it can take more than a year. It's kind of tedious, honestly. And then from the reporter side of this, you know, particularly for the big journals like Science, New England Journal of Medicine, Nature, they give us a heads up under embargo. So we see what's coming a little bit ahead of time. And then we have time to interview the scientists and prepare our stories. And also, very importantly, go to other external scientists, ask them for comment, also embargo. So we have a little bit of time to like properly prepare a story. So that's sort of how this all happened. BC, before coronavirus, that's how studies would get covered. So this has all been completely upended during the pandemic. So even before the pandemic, there is what's called a preprint server, where because the journal process takes a lot of time, scientists would upload basically their draft manuscripts and to share them with each other in the community. But reporters would very rarely ever cover these draft manuscripts because they were known to be drafts and they were sort of just shared among the community. Now, during the pandemic, because there's been so much interest in the science and also a need to, you know, a very valid need to share science quickly as it's been found, there's been a lot of stuff that's been published to bioarchive. And then often what happens is something gets published to bioarchive. There's a lot of chatter about it. You know, BioTwitter and EpiTwitter goes totally nuts. And then some poor science writer, or even worse, some poor, you know, general assignment news writer's editor says, what's this study? Like, please go write it up. And the poor writer then has, you know, like a couple hours to write up a science study that just got posted to the internet. And these have not been peer reviewed. And they then have to write very quickly without it being under embargo and not having time to write them quickly. So for example, this January preprint here went up, this was I think January 31st, went totally viral on the internet. And it suggested that the novel coronavirus had parts of four sections of its RNA sequence that were very, very uncannily similar to HIV, which then fed into the conspiracy theory that it had been made in a lab. So this goes totally wild on the internet. Stories are written about it. And then ultimately, as you can see here in my screenshot, it was withdrawn, right? It would have never made it through a journal, but because of sort of the speed at which things are being picked up and circulating around the internet right now, they aren't going through the normal process of science. On the right here, when we started getting a lot of antibody tests, there was a preprint that went up on bioarchive. And actually this study done by Stanford, the professors were really promoting it the second it hit bioarchive, and they went out and did a lot of press. And, you know, they were saying that basically that their study found that the COVID infection was a lot more common than we had realized. Suggesting that, you know, maybe we could move towards reopening faster because we were closer to herd immunity than we thought we were. And that got written up a lot. And then, you know, later on, you know, as you can see in the lower BuzzFeed article, Stephanie Lee, who's a great writer, summed it up as scientists are mad, because then a lot of people really deeply scrutinized and were like, you have a lot of problems with your methodology here. And then they, you know, heavily revised their manuscript. But the problem is a lot of people wrote about the first version, not a lot of people wrote about the revised version, which lowered the numbers. And I think this is sort of a process that a lot of reporters continue to struggle with, which is how do we write about preprints responsibly? How do we keep track of them when they get revised or withdrawn, when usually it's the first version that gets the most attention? Just making sure I can, yep. Okay, so coming to the end here, conspiracy theories. This is sort of another sort of tricky thing for a public health reporter, which is, you know, there are a lot of conspiracy theories that can circulate on the internet right now. Vaccines obviously are a hot topic. And, you know, the question is, when do we address them? When do we ignore them? Do I write about Bill Gates putting chips into the vaccines? Do I pretend that conspiracy theory does not exist? I think it is very much a sort of case-by-case basis. What I've learned from talking to other editors is often that, you know, you don't want to necessarily amplify a conspiracy theory when it's kind of just bubbling or at low levels, but if it's something that is circulating so much in your community and in the readers that you serve, that it's sort of reached a very high level, that might be a good time to address it. But another thing I've learned, especially from ProPublica's audience team, is to think about what is going to get shared, particularly in headlines. So there are kind of two examples here that kind of come to the same conclusion in the article. But if you think about what might be shared in a headline or a tweet here, on the left, there's just the question, can the coronavirus vaccine cause Bell's palsy? So if you are just sharing a tweet or the head, or you just see the headline, a reader might walk away with the impression of like, oh, there's a link between the vaccine and Bell's palsy. Versus on the right here, this example says, fact check, it's likely unrelated. So what I've been encouraged to do as a best practice is to always think about putting the right answer in my headline. Like, put the thing you want to be shared. Don't just ask the question or repeat the conspiracy theory in the headline particularly, or in the social copy, because you don't want to be part of perpetuating the conspiracy theory, and always try to put the thing that you would like to be shared. And that's something that I just hadn't really thought about, because I'm not like a super social oriented person by nature, and I'm used to writing like 5,000 word drafts. And so this is something that I've started to think about, which is like, what is the piece that's going to be shared? The last thing I wanted to just share here is I've really had to think about biases. So every single person has been touched by this pandemic. Every reporter is living through it at the same time as we're reporting on it. Oftentimes, normally, again, like before coronavirus, I would write about subjects where I was coming in as an outsider to report on a situation. It's not something I'm living through. This is totally different. I am living through it just as everybody who I'm writing about. So I have to be aware of like my own preconceived notions or my own biases coming in. We have a lot of editors at ProPublica who are parents, for example. If they're assigning a story about schools, they might have opinions about whether schools should be open, or they might have opinions about school policies. I had this interesting exchange where I had written a story about which touched on restaurant, indoor dining. And a woman wrote to me very vehemently saying there is no data on indoor locations causing more spread. And I kind of wrote her back and said, well, thanks for writing to me. Here's some studies that I can share with you. And she wrote me back and she was like, okay, I admit that now that you've shared this data with me, that there is data. And then she said, well, you see, my husband is a restaurant owner. And I said, okay, I understand. This is obviously a very emotional subject for you. And like, we all just have a stake in it. So that's something I just try to remember. So I also have to remember every source I talk to has their own motivation and bias as well, whether that's a person on the street or Dr. Fauci. Like, and so I have to fact check them all with equal rigor. And like, that's my job as a reporter, which is to like not let anybody off the hook. So that's it from me. This is my email. If any of you guys have questions at any point further along that you think of, you're always welcome to get in touch with me. But we have time for questions right now.
Thank you, Caroline. Maybe I'll ask you a question since you started with Dr. Fauci, and I have a couple coming in already. But if you had a first-year student, when you talked about, we all at Holy Cross trust Dr. Fauci, as you would guess. But if you were talking to a first-year student or a person and said, how do you, between a person on the street or something I read on the web, how do you actually investigate? How do you do that checking?
Oh, like what's my process of fact-checking?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm going to try to keep this answer short. Sure. It is a kind of a long process. So when I have a lot of time for a long story, I actually have an obnoxious process, which involves numbering every sentence and then a separate document, which where I cite the source for every single sentence and then make sure that like every single sentence, like I can literally pull it back. So if you were to point to any sentence in my story and say like, where did you get that from? I can immediately go to my Google Doc and like pull the document or say like it came from this tape from this, you know, interview I did at 14 minutes and 35 seconds or whatever. And this is because I am so paranoid, and like every ProPublica reporter is super paranoid. Like we all have our own fact-checking systems. And especially when a story is like a 5,000 word magazine story, you have to have a system for fact-checking. That changes slightly when you are, say, co-reporting with another reporter. So then we sometimes have systems where we like highlight different lines in the story to be like, you got that line, I got that line. But a lot of it is there a document to back it up? Is there an interview to back it up? When there is an interview, I think sometimes the evidence is you have to cite who said it, when they said it. But even so, I think there's sort of a level that goes beyond that. So, you know, for example, Dr. Fauci said to me in an interview that he thought that children down to first graders would be able, the vaccine would be authorized for them by September. I could run a story saying Dr. Fauci said that, end of story, right? For me, that is a little bit unsatisfying because I wanted to at least test it a little bit. So what I did was I called up all the manufacturers and said, hey, what's your clinical trial schedule for kids? And basically what I found was the only manufacturer who had a shot of hitting that timeline was Pfizer. And so I wanted to at least give readers that information, which is, you know, Moderna's kids trials would not be able to make that timeline. Pfizer has a hope of making that timeline. It's not guaranteed though. But I'll put that next to what Dr. Fauci says and basically cite my source. Like, Dr. Fauci said this to me at this time. This is exactly what he said. And then here's what all the manufacturers said. So kind of like showing my homework.
Okay. Harder for the rest of us to do. I'm grateful that you're doing it. Teresa Esquivel, who's the class of 23, has a question.
Hi. I was wondering how you thought this pandemic compared to what you've observed with other health crises in terms of misinformation, like Ebola, swine flu, things like that. What have you seen in the media that either differs or reflects those patterns?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think what has been most surprising to me is how political a lot of the health topics have gotten. I haven't seen that before. So just politicization of things like mask wearing. I don't recall that before. However, I also don't think the US has been challenged quite on this scale before, where it's affect, you know, something like H1N1, for example, hasn't, you know, didn't affect Americans' daily life and stress them in to the same extent. So we don't know what would have happened in that case. Similarly, H1N1 did not barely hit the US. You know, we had a couple of people who, travelers who came back to the US, didn't affect Americans' daily lives. And so I don't know that it's fair to have sort of an apples to apples comparison of what would have happened. I think some of the misinformation sort of has grown out of a base, you know, for example, from like anti-vax misinformation has sort of just found a foothold and grown more. So that's not new to me, as opposed to having grown. But I do think I've been surprised by the extent of politicization. That's been new.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Thank you. David Pritchard, who's also a second year student, has a question.
Hi, I was just wondering, you were talking about identifying biases in some of your sources, and I was just wondering how you go about identifying biases in people that maybe might not be so readily apparent when you're first talking to them, and making sure that you don't sort of convey, or you make sure you identify those biases when you're doing the actual reporting.
Yeah, that is a fantastic question. I think a lot of it, may not be so much that I'm, you know, specifically, you know, interrogating a person so much as making sure that I am trying to have a breadth of reporting sources. So when I'm covering a subject, I try my best not to just, you know, interview two people. And so I'll try to talk to, oftentimes I will talk to people who don't end up being quoted in my article. There's kind of, you know, you'll hear people say like, you only print like 10% of your notebook. And that's because I'm trying to make sure that I've covered the landscape. And there's, you know, you'll hear a lot of journalism professors say like, the last question you should ask is who else should I talk to at the end of an interview? I actually think that on top of that question, I try to sometimes ask who disagrees with you, but you respect, you know, because when I say who else should I talk to, I might end up just being in a little echo chamber, you know, of people who all agree with each other and then just miss the whole other side. And that's what I'm often worried about, right? So I ask variations of that question of, you know, whether it's like, is there somebody who disagrees with you, but you still respect? So I'm not asking for somebody who's totally off the wall. Or I say like, you know, is there somebody, what would be a criticism of your position? You know, if you were to critique your own position, what would you say? You know, and sometimes people have really interesting answers where like they, especially if they're a professor or somebody who's in a kind of controversial area, they know what all the arguments are against their own position. But when I'm trying to bring it out of them by saying like, you know, oh, you're a smart person, tell me what is, you know, the best argument against your own position, you know, they start to like reveal kind of the holes in their own argument. And it's really interesting to sort of, once you've gotten that out of them or gotten some other names out of them, I usually try to talk to so many people that I start to get to the point where I'm not hearing anything new at all. Or if I'm trying to reconstruct an event, I'm reporting at the point where I can practically tell people what happened because I've talked to so many people that I know it so well. That's the point where I feel like I can stop reporting. And again, they might not all appear in my story, but that's when I have confidence that I'm not missing things. I hope that helps.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. So we have a lot of interested sophomores. I'll turn to Christian Bachman.
Thank you. Hello. I try and keep up with the news as best as I can. And I'm just curious, and this is a very specific question, but how Andrew Cuomo went from being praised to then maligned, and if now there can be kind of a final verdict of how he handled COVID-19, just because New York and the city was just such a vital hub of our country. So I'm really curious to know like the truth, what is true and what's false behind how he dealt with it.
Wow, that's an interesting question that I don't know that I can answer because, you know, I don't hold the truth here. So, and you know, partly what I'll say is that I do think that sometimes even in the news media, the news media can be a little bit of lemmings where we kind of follow each other. So I do think that sometimes when like one significant news story comes out, that oftentimes that can engender others, you know, like one big story comes out that prompts other reporters to continue looking in the same area. So like one big story on nursing homes, for example, and how any governor treated it might invite other reporters to look deeper in the same direction. I haven't closely followed actually specific coverage on Cuomo, so I can't comment, you know, on like what made things turn with him, but I would just say in general, oftentimes when things turn on a politician, there are like one or two stories that sort of make the tide turn and then other reporters start digging deeper and then there are more things that happen. I'm not sure that there will be one final verdict. And I actually think that that's often really unfair for there to be like someone's an angel or someone's a demon kind of casting. I think is any of that type of reporting or portrayal, like if I'm doing a profile of someone, I think that to not have gray or not to have sides of that, probably to me is a warning sign that I'm missing nuance in a person, right? So I suspect that Governor Cuomo has done good things in this pandemic as well as bad things, and that anybody who's trying to say like he's a total angel and has done everything right, or he's, you know, the worst governor ever, is probably missing sides of the story. But I think that people don't like those narratives a lot. Like, I think people like to be like they're the best or the worst. People like superlatives. They're easy to digest.
We leave it to professors to give complicated narratives, and we want journalists to give clearer ones. So
yeah.
Lauren Pettengill is a senior.
Hi, first of all, thank you so much for your time tonight. So I know, like, from experience and also talking to other people, that the media is often thought to be like a fear-mongering source, and where you emphasize like the worst case scenarios, like you just reported the deaths and all that stuff. And so as a science major who also has anxiety and is afraid of everything, like, I know science is constantly changing and that unknown is really scary. So how do you like avoid fear-mongering while still providing the most up-to-date information when it actually is something that's kind of like scary, like deaths and stuff like that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think a lot about trying, my hope for a lot of the stories that I've written is to leave people in a place where they feel smarter and more equipped to make smart decisions, you know? And that means giving them actual information. And whether that is scary information or not, like, I think when people have information, they generally feel less anxious, and information that they can understand. And so one of the things that I don't like about overly simple narratives is that I think that that presumes that your reader is dumb. And I don't think any reader in the US is dumb. And like, I don't think any science topic is too complicated for any reader to understand. And like, the problem is not the reader, the problem is me. Like, if I cannot get you to understand it, it means that I am not writing well enough and I need to like rewrite it better so that you can understand it. Like, that's my job, to make it understandable. So that's one. I think also, again, this goes back to like, is this information useful to you? Is it useful to my reader that the CDC is investigating a possible death of someone to the COVID vaccine? Or should I wait and find out whether that guy actually died because of the COVID vaccine? Like, to me, I would wait and find out if the guy died. And if the guy did die because of the vaccine, probably I would write at that point. But if there's an investigation of a death where the death may or may not have been because of the vaccine, to me, it's not really actionable information for my reader. So I would personally prefer to wait because it doesn't seem helpful. So that's kind of like one of those questions I have, is like, what can my readers do off of this information? If the answer is they can't really do anything except freak out, I'd probably wait. And then the last thing, just because you talked about death specifically, I think, again, my presumption is none of my readers are too stupid and I just need to explain things more deeply to them. The death rate itself, like infection fatality rates, were a huge cause of problems right at the beginning because they were jumping around all over the place and they were like, you know, one day it'd be 2%, the next day it'd be 3%. And like, oh my gosh, like, is it rising higher? Is it becoming more deadly? And I was like, oh my gosh, I wish we would just not report our mortality rates at all because this is like really unhelpful. And I think it really helped to explain to readers that like right at the beginning of the pandemic, the most easy thing to count is people who are dead because they're the most obvious. They're the easiest to find. The hardest thing to find is people who are sick but have close to no symptoms. So asymptomatic people. But how do you calculate the mortality rate of a virus? You put dead people over the total number of cases. It is really hard to accurately capture the total number of cases early on in the pandemic. It is easiest to calculate and find the number of deaths. So early on in the pandemic, one, this number is super, super, super squishy, and it's probably going to be higher than the true number. And people understand that. You can explain that to them. And so one, like, don't put too much on this number. And two, again, I ask the question, like, what do my readers care about when they look at the mortality rate? They're looking at that and going, if I get the COVID, am I going to die, right? That's what they care about. And so what I think is more useful information for people is looking at risks according to age and comorbidity and kind of focusing on those sorts of numbers and saying, really, like, whether it's 2% or 2.3% or whatever, it's not that useful a number for you for right now, and explaining why, and then being like, you can put that number aside. But again, I'm in a super privileged position where I work at a place where I can do deep dives and I can explain that to people. And so I feel really lucky. I hope that helps.
So you're talking about super privilege. I'm thinking of a story when I was much younger where there was a scandal that came out about a religious figure. I visited the New York Times one time. I was there visiting for something and talking about it, and that came up. And they said to me, well, we didn't believe that story. I said, but you wrote about it. And they said, well, it was in page 18 and it was buried here and here's why we did it. But because other people published it, we had to tell the story. And it was a reminder to me that in a media environment where stories are going to come out anyway, do you have that luxury of choosing how you'll report something? Or do you have to, their argument was other people were publishing about it, so we had to put something in and say what we thought. Or report that it was being published.
I don't believe in that at all.
Okay.
I also believe that today there's no such thing as burying something in page 18 when everything's online.
Right. That's impossible. Right. That's the point. Yeah.
There's no such thing as page 18 anymore. And I don't think anything should be published unless you can totally stand behind it as a reporter. Like, your name is on the byline.
Sure. So, accusations are made or whatever, right, but yeah, right. It was kind of, you know.
Yeah, I don't know. I personally would not be super comfortable with that.
Bella Lana, who is a student in Jeff and Dennis's class, who is a junior, has a question. So it must be a good one if she's in that class.
Oh, I hope so. So basically similar to that last question, and also kind of about what you were saying about your fact checking, like in your own career, because of this pandemic and also like other stuff going on, like the political climate, there's been a lot of claims made, like particularly on social media, that don't have like a ton of like evidence to support them, and they have like the catchy like headlines and stuff like that. So it's kind of easy to see something online and just take it at face value like that. But in terms of like the readers, do you have any like advice or anything to kind of consume information like more responsibly?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, I think if you see something that looks really interesting or catchy to you, you can, you know, I think the first question is like, who posted this? You know, who is this from? Is this from somebody totally random? Is this from somebody that you would potentially trust? Is this, you know, is there a link to evidence or to something, you know, like, is this claim backed up? You know, sometimes my family members will send me like a tweet or a Instagram link to something that's like super alarming. And they'll be like, did you see this? You know, and I'm like, you know, like my process usually is like, okay, what does this say? Is there a link or something attached to it? If there's a link, I'll check out the link and see what, you know, what it says behind the link. If there isn't, you know, I will try to like fact check it myself and be like, okay, this says that, like, hypothetically, let's say like COVID causes HIV, you know, I'm totally making this up here. And then I would do a Google search or do a PubMed search or whatever and see if there's any link. You know, sometimes if it's something that's circulating widely, there will be some media organization that has already done a fact check or a debunk or whatever. So you can just through a quick Google, you know, oftentimes people have already done what you have looked for. So that can be really fast. So I think like before you reshare and perpetuate the information, you can do a quick check for yourself. So that's kind of one thing. I think the other thing that is useful to do is try to sort of slowly over time curate your own list of trusted sources, which is either a Twitter list or whatever, I don't know what social media you want to use, of people who you find like consistently share information that you find sound. And it's not that they're never going to be wrong, like, but I think one good sign is like, I look for people who say like, I don't know as answers. Like these are people who I trust. So like I've found like, you know, like for example, there's a biostatistician, Natalie Dean at University of Florida, who is very active on Twitter, and she does, you know, these like tweet threads that are like, think like an epidemiologist. And I've learned a lot from her. One time I sent her an email being like, can I interview you for the story? And she was like, I'm sorry, that's not my domain. I don't know. I wouldn't be a good person to interview. Like, I respected her a lot for that, for being like, I don't know. And then she gave me some names of other people who were like, you can try these other people instead. So I kind of look for people who I feel like I can trust because of how they've behaved over time. And I kind of curate them into lists. So I have like Twitter lists I follow. And that helps me feel like, you know, hopefully I have sources that I feel are good sources. But yeah, I still try to, sometimes I will like retweet something and I'll be like, wait, maybe I should check that one. But hopefully if I'm curating lists of people over time that are good sources, the chances that I'm gonna retweet something totally off the wall are low. But yeah, it's a struggle even for me.
So we have more questions than we can do in the time we have, but I'll take one more from Olivia Kernan, class of 23.
Hi, I'm sorry, I'm having a bit of a camera issue tonight.
That's fine.
But my question would be, this is sort of broad, but what do you hope that your work, because of especially the nature of it being more of deep dives, of really looking into the things that you want to know, what would you hope it means in the future when people are looking back at this time?
Wow, what a question to end on. Oh. I mean, I think, man, geez, that's a great question. I think for me, a lot of it has been trying to amplify voices of people who I think don't really have a huge platform. I've talked to a lot of essential workers, nurses, ICU workers from all over the country, from rural areas, and tried to bring them to my readers to kind of show what they've been going through. We just did a story on vaccine disparities, my colleague Mariam Jamil and I. And Mariam and I were talking, like trying to show how barriers can be designed into the system that usually impact people who really are vulnerable and actually need the vaccine most, that, you know, whether intentionally or not, create inequity in the system. So for example, Dodger Stadium in LA is one of the biggest vaccine sites in the US right now. It is drive-through only. Chinatown is like 1 mile away from Dodger Stadium. And a lot of the residents, a lot of the seniors in Chinatown do not have cars. So they're literally right next to one of the biggest vaccine sites in the world, and they cannot get a vaccine there because they need a drive to go there. They don't have a car. So this is like a barrier that's literally designed into this vaccine site. And they don't have money to like rent an Uber to just hang out and wait because the lines are really long. So they've just been overlooked when they live right next to this vaccine site. So I think my hope has been to elevate voices of people that, you know, might not have otherwise been paid attention to is one hope. And I think the other hope is that I think that there's often been times in this pandemic where it's easy to maybe feel apathetic and feel like it's, there's not much you can do. But my hope is that I've been able to point out that there's accountability on many levels, like for officials and also for individuals in having control over the narrative of this pandemic, and that there's data to back it up, that we all have a part to play. So that would be my hope. Thank you for that great question.
It was a great question. It was a great answer. I'm sorry we can't get to the other questions, but we do have Caroline's email address if you need to. And
yes,
just thank you so, so much for being here and for helping us think about what goes into good journalism, the processes that you go through, the challenges that are there on short notice news and, you know, open science and all of those things. So I learned a lot and I'm really grateful to you. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Good night.
Okay, good night.